So when we talk about the brainstem, and we talk about very specific levels of the brainstem, and we talk about the cranial nerve nuclei, way back in the beginning of this series, when we were discussing the gross anatomy of the nervous system, we talked a little bit about gray matter and white matter. Gray matter, neuronal cell bodies and proximal dendrites. White matter, myelinated axons that are bundled together to form tracts, and some tracts are then bundled together to form funiculi, and so on. Now, in the cortex and in the spinal cord, these delineations between gray matter and white matter are pretty cut and dried, and they're pretty, they're just pretty regulated and normal, or pretty standard looking, is what I'm trying to say. And you can see in our cartoons that in the spinal cord, the gray matter's on the inside and the white matter's on the outside. And when we're talking about our cortex, our gray matter's on the outside and our white matter's on the inside. In the brainstem, things get a little less clear in that you can see all kinds of areas. So here's some white matter. I want to draw your attention to the fact that these three sections are stained with a myelin stain. So the myelin looks dark and the gray matter looks light. So it's kind of flipped. But the bottom line is, here's a bunch of fibers. Here is some cell bodies. Here's a whole bunch of cell bodies around the cerebral aqueduct. Here's a great big bundle of fibers. And then you can see that, oh, there's some cell bodies. There's some cell bodies. There's cell bodies all over the place in here with fibers interspersed. And so what the heck is going on? Well, the brainstem is a transitional area between this gray on the inside, white on the outside, and the white on the inside and gray on the outside. So that's part of what's going on. And we have within the brainstem, we have very specific nuclei for very specific cranial nerves. Those are all named, and those are, for the most part, pretty easy to find. But there's something else that lives in the gray matter within the brainstem that's really important and that I really want to tell you about. And that's the reticular formation. The reticular formation is a very diffuse group of neurons that lives within the medulla oblongata and the pons. They're not formed into any specific clusters. They're kind of loose aggregations of cells within the medulla and the pons. They receive sensory information, both somatic, so from your surface, and visceral, from your internal organs. They don't receive real specific information, like they don't receive, oh, a mosquito bit me, or oh, a Q-tip ran across my arm, or oh, this part of my stomach hurts. But they have kind of a general awareness that something's going on, but not real specific. The reticular formation then sends that information up through the brainstem into the diencephalon, which, remember, is continuous with the brainstem, and then on up into the cortex. So it goes through your thalamus, which is a sensory gateway. It goes through the hypothalamus, which we'll talk about later. It has a lot of regulatory functions, and then on up to your cortex. There are also then descending projections of that reticular formation down your spinal cord. Okay, and this is going to interact with the lateral and ventral corticospinal tracts and all of the other neurons that are impacting on the ventral horns to kind of have an effect on your muscles. So it's the reticular formation, it's kind of a general awareness thing, an awareness of motion, an awareness of sensation that is very important for just kind of a general state of arousal. And I don't mean arousal in any sort of romantic kind of way. I mean arousal in the sense that you're awake, okay? So noise, bright light, vibration, those things can wake you up out of a sleep because your reticular formation is getting those sensations from the periphery and then relaying them up to your cortex without you even being aware of what woke you, okay? That's the gist of it, not the specifics. That's just kind of the general gist. There are also some really important things in the reticular formation that have to do with your heart rate and your respiratory rate. So centers within the reticular formation are setting the tone for breathing and heartbeat, which is one of the reasons why if you have damage to your brainstem via injury or stroke, it can kill you because the neurons talking to your heart and talking to your lungs would no longer be working and you would cease to breathe and your heart would cease to beat. The reticular activating system is also part of this reticular formation, and it is what then is responsible for you being not in a coma. So if when you hear about people having brainstem damage and then being in a vegetative state, it's because their reticular activating system is not sending information up through the thalamus and up to the cortex for you to be awake. And you do end up in what is called a coma or a vegetative state. So in summary, what do I want you to know about the brainstem? So what are the different regions? Which is the most cranial? Which is the most caudal? Be able to describe the most prominent surface features of each area. Think about the olive, think about the tectum, those kinds of things. What cranial nerves are associated with each area of the brainstem? Okay, what are in the medulla? Which cranial nerves are in the pons? Which cranial nerves are in the midbrain? And what are some of those internal features that I talked about? Think about decussations. Think about the fourth ventricle. Think about the cerebral aqueduct. And then lastly, what I want you to think about is what is the reticular formation? Where is it? And why is it really, really, really important? If you understand all of these concepts, then you're ready for the assessment.